We'll start this session. The title of this session is Hacking Blockchain, and it's presented by Konstantinos Karagiannis, Chief Technology Officer, Security Consulting, BT. Let's welcome our speaker.
Thanks. All righty. Okay, so before we begin, if Satoshi Nakamoto's here, he's required to stand up. No? Yeah, yeah. That's like the second funniest shirt usually at a hacker show. I'm the real Satoshi Nakamoto. Yeah. okay, so we're at a very interesting time in InfoSec again. It's another sea change. So if you go way, way back to the terminal and mainframe days, we had one security paradigm where you could trust what you were getting. And then we dove into the web and web applications and we realized that, whoa, we can't really trust what we're getting anymore. So that was like the first big sea change, right? And then we moved on to Web 2.0, a whole bunch of new hacking problems sprung up. We went into mobile apps, a whole bunch of new problems sprung up. That kind of thing happens when you build without thinking about security. So I just want to make sure that as we're all racing the blockchain, trying to implement it for everything short of text editors, you know, like if you name it, it's on the blockchain now. I want to make sure that we're not diving in so quickly that we don't look at some of the flaws that we can hopefully avoid. You know? So it all started Halloween 2008. A certain paper was published. A lot of people read it with interest. If you'd been part of the cypherpunk community, the idea of digital cash was something that had been floating around for quite a while. It was made popular in 1999 by Neal Stephenson in the novel Cryptonomicon, and people were obsessed with the idea of having some kind of digital cash. No gold to back it, not that gold backs money for the last 100 years anyway, but some kind of digital cash that we could trust. Well, Satoshi came up with a great idea. He called it Bitcoin, the idea that you can have something digital that has intrinsic value because of its scarcity, because of its difficulty to make, something that could change the world. He really did have some lofty goals when he came up with this. But remember that highlighted line, because when I first read this paper years ago, that's the line that stopped me. Transactions that are computationally impractical to reverse. That's going to haunt us, and we're going to take a look a little later on at just how important that line is in that paper and how it might not exactly be true. But anyway, Bitcoin did come out. It did start slowly rising in value. There were a few bumps in the road, a few negative bits of press that maybe made it soar even quicker, like the Silk Road. But for one reason or another, people started using it. His altruistic goals were met. You know, he envisioned giving money to people in countries that couldn't even get a bank account. The idea that half the people in the world don't have access to banking. They don't have enough money to even open a bank account if there was one near them. So he had this idea of something that could easily be sent, exchanged, interacted with, immune to any kind of centralized government and collapse and things like that. It also turned out to be a strong investment. One of the most fun things about Bitcoin was how it would store in value and, you know, sometimes plummet. You know, I made some money off of it a few times. I got it at the right time. It's kind of funny, too, because the first transaction that really launched Bitcoin that made it become a thing for sharing money was what I like to think of as the $5 million pizza. So this developer, Laszlo, sent 10,000 Bitcoin to someone who was willing to use his credit card to send him two Papa John's pizzas. If you do the math, that means each pizza is worth $5 million today. So I hope it really tasted good. I've had Papa John's, I doubt it. But so that's the $5 million pizza. But obviously, people had to spend Bitcoins to make them a real thing. So he positioned cryptocurrency. He positioned blockchain. Satoshi, the anonymous Satoshi. You know, no one knows who he is. Some people said it's Nick Szabo. Some people said Hal Finney. Everyone has their own theory. I wish it was me, but it's not. He really positioned this concept of blockchain. He created the movement. So for those of you who aren't too clear on blockchain, we're going to just spend like 2 minutes just on the super basics, so whenever I bring up things, it won't sound too crazy. But the idea is really simple. It's that you can have a couple of parties, they can exchange some form of data with each other. Originally, Bitcoin was for spending, you know, so you can exchange the idea of paying someone. But it's not limited to spending. It could be some kind of contract, some other kind of digital asset, two parties can exchange it without a third party actually controlling it, some kind of central organization. So depending on the network, that transaction will be verified instantly, or it'll be queued to be handled later on by the network. Now that transaction gets lumped in with a bunch of other transactions into something called a block. That block's identified by a hash, and each block, when it eventually gets strung up in a chain, refers to the hash before. So there's no way to really fake it. The chain kind of knows that the next block logically belongs there. They have to be validated to be added. So when you buy something and the system validates that you have the money to pay for it, it gets added to the transactions, put on this long blockchain. You know, in the early days, the blockchain could be downloaded in a few minutes. Now it's about, you know, close to 100 gigabytes for Bitcoin. So you have to download this gigantic thing if you want to be one of the nodes. Now, miners have to do some work on each of the blocks. And that way, when they do the work and compare the hashes, it validates that it's a valid hash. And also, it keeps it from becoming easily fooled by a computational power attack. So the idea is that you have to do this work, and the work gets harder and harder. So over the years, every 4 years, it gets harder and harder exponentially to create more Bitcoin, for example. And other networks take the same idea. So the harder the math gets, the harder it gets to win any money. So even though miners are rewarded and they will get Bitcoin in the early days, nowadays, if you don't have a supercomputing farm, you're not going to get any Bitcoin. It's just not going to happen. The competition's too fierce. But when they're rewarded for doing their proof of work, the block gets added to the majority chain, so this big, long, snaking list of transactions is a ledger. And Satoshi wanted that ledger to be viewable by everyone to keep things fair. So you can at any time look and see, hey, this person really does have this money to pay me. So it's distributed ledger at its best. And if you try to submit an altered block, this is the basic security idea. It would change the hash, and everything else would be rejected. So if you try to force in some fake block to give yourself some money, the network would go, not really, and then throw it away. The majority consensus rules, it would know that you tried to do something wonky, essentially. So this is just a basic idea that everything is very transparent and very trustworthy. That's the basics. People have taken that and moved it for money. You can have digital assets. Artists, for example, can have songs and get paid instantly in micropayments. An interesting idea is to use blockchain for black box identity. You can have all your identity in this sort of like box on a blockchain, and then whatever application needs a piece of your identity to validate something could take just that piece, interact, and then everything else remains secret. You don't really need your bank to know your medical records. You don't need your doctor to know how much money you have in the bank, although your insurance company probably knows. So you have to like segregate things. So that's one idea of blockchain. You can have verifiable data. For example, do you want to have a title to a house in the blockchain? It could prove that you're you. If the government collapses, well, look at that. It's an immutable record. It's distributed, decentralized. So it's a great idea that this information is widely visible. And smart contracts, of course, and we'll get into examples of those in the hacking section. The idea that you can have contracts interact without a human being involved. It's probably good to have humans involved, as you'll see. So attacks past and present, a lot of these so far haven't been against blockchain's concept, but more the implementation. And that's really where a lot of hacking comes in, right? I mean, you can install some secure server, but if you implement it poorly, there will be some way in. I've seen this in the most extravagant setups, and there are times when we go in and we have to do an ethical hack on something that's off-the-shelf software. It's like, well, why would you hack it if it's off-the-shelf software? Because we're testing the implementation. So when I go in and test financial applications and blockchain applications, I'm looking for the mistakes they made in implementing these grandiose ideas, basically. So that brings it to a caveat. I'm not allowed to discuss actual vulnerabilities found in my company's clients. That would get me in a lot of trouble. So what I chose to do is I'm going to give some publicized examples, and there are some holes in those stories that I'm going to fill in with some best guesses based on things that I've seen in the environments. So I figure that's fair. If I'm wrong, it doesn't matter because I've seen the attacks work the way I'm going to describe them. So if I'm a little off on those details because they didn't publicize everything, at least you see stuff that really worked in the end. So the first bit of code that ever manifested as a blockchain flaw was in Bitcoin itself. So this guy, Art Forrest, he identified this one return bug. Now, it looks like such a simple little thing, but basically how it was doing is when it was validating transactions, it was leaving a one on top of the stack, just to keep it real simple. So what that meant is it would be possible to have it kind of do a quick loop and pay with somebody else's money. Satoshi saw that as a potential disaster. Blockchain and Bitcoin were in their infancy. It was only out about half a year or so. So he kept this very secret. For someone who was so all about transparency and public awareness, he was worried that if this got out that early, it would sort of, you know, destroy Bitcoin. So he kept it quiet till he could roll out a patch and then majority consensus could kick in. And when that happens, all of a sudden, all the nodes were safe and protected against this. But what's interesting is Satoshi had a belief that early users would want to maintain the value of Bitcoin. They had like their own stake in it. So if this hacker, instead of reporting it to Satoshi, had decided to take advantage of this and started spending other people's money in the early days, he would have basically devalued Bitcoin completely. So his own holdings would be lost too. So he did the right thing, maybe because he wanted Bitcoin to soar, not necessarily just altruism, but it's hard to say. So from there, we moved on to pretty much the first big disaster. So Mt. Gox. Now, in the early days, no one knew how to get Bitcoin. You know, you can meet someone in a shady bar or something and, you know, do the e-wallet thing and try and buy Bitcoin from someone. But most people would go and buy Bitcoin from an exchange. So Mt. Gox was set up to be a Magic the Gathering website, and then it was reconfigured to be a blockchain exchange. So what could go wrong, right, when a site is made to be an amateur gaming site and then it gets converted to a financial center? It's a foolproof plan. I think Citibank did the same thing. So there were a whole lot of mistakes made in the coding. And in June 2011, $8 million of Bitcoin were stolen because the first mistake they made was they built this system and they didn't actually take advantage of the underlying technology. So they had a system where you could do a certain amount of trading inside Mt. Gox without ever touching the blockchain, without ever going out and letting all those machines, all those nodes on the network validate the transactions. So in June 2011, supposedly someone got in with an admin password. There was no two-factor authentication, it was just a password, and was able to move coins around without ever touching the blockchain and then withdraw them. So by the time anyone realized what was going on, $8 million had been stolen, and Bitcoin took its first big hit. So they fixed that by adding two-factor authentication. You know, again, it was a gaming site turned into a financial one. But then in February 2014, something really bizarre happened. $460 million vanished, and this spelled the end of Mt. Gox. Now, there was something in Bitcoin from the very beginning called transaction malleability. The idea that before a transaction gets fully validated, you have to trust the signature that says, hey, you know, I'm making this transaction. Because of transaction malleability, it is in theory possible to write a little quick recursive bit of code that constantly keeps trying to make a transaction. And whoever this attacker was, supposedly, according to the CEO, was able to exploit that and get all this money out before the system realized what was going on. There's a lot of skepticism about this, because all other software instances around the world knew about transaction malleability and wrote around it. It was just a very simple thing to code around. But Mt. Gox's code was just very primitive. They had no version control software. Bug fixes were often delayed. It was just like whenever Karpolis would get around to it. Literally, he brought in an emergency meeting guys to help him on a Friday night to fix some problems. And then at like 8 o'clock, he's like, all right, we'll resume on Monday morning. It's like, what? We have, you know, a crisis on our hands here. He's like, no, we'll resume Monday morning. He had a very laid back attitude, and it led to the bankruptcy of this company. Some people think he's sitting on all that Bitcoin and might one day try to spend it, but it would show up. We'd be able to know it was that Bitcoin. So around 3 million Bitcoins are missing from the ecosystem now because of that disaster. And if you know about Bitcoin, you know that it's only gonna have 21 million total coins by the year 2140. So in a weird way, this makes it even more scarce, because now we're down to 18 million, not counting some of the other ones that people lose from mistakes with wallets and things like that. Another attack against infrastructure housing something was Gaycoin. So this is a really interesting attack. So they were using something called a cold wallet. Now, a cold wallet is a wallet that's not connected to the internet. So you could keep your currency, like Bitcoin or whatever, offline, so nothing can touch it. So they were using a multi-sig cold wallet. A couple of sources had to sign in before the Bitcoin could be extracted from it. However, through a clever attack, and I've done this exact attack against a client, I can't say who, basically they were able to do a server disruption. They were able to exploit an infrastructure flaw in the server, cause it to reboot, and then bypass the multi-sig cold wallet, go straight to the hot wallet, which is the wallet that's connected to the internet. By doing that, they were able to just start siphoning out. It wasn't such a big attack, 250 Bitcoin. I mean, today that would be a big, that'd be $250,000 right now, and 185,000 of Ethereum's cryptocurrency. So again, it shows you that you can have this wonderful trust environment where these machines all are very open and transparent. But if you make a simple mistake like a server flaw, you know, an implementation, you could bypass all your security settings. Some of the most damaging, though, goes right back to code. Ethereum had a huge problem in just May 2016. They found a contract flaw. So the DAO is a decentralized organization. And what it does, it's autonomous. So it automatically tries to resolve contracts. So you could think of it as a place where you can come up with a good business idea and the machine will take a vote, sort of, and decide if it's going to give you funding for that project. So let's say Airbnb, you can make a blockchain Airbnb and put it on this and it'll vote and people will say, yeah, I want to put my money into that business. The idea that anyone can like rent a house. So it was running through all these smart contracts and there was one huge flaw in there. So the system allowed you to get out of a deal. So if there was a product coming out or a contract coming out that you weren't that interested in, you can take your ETH out, you know, you wouldn't have to pay, you wouldn't have to be part of the system. A hacker found that there's a recursive flaw, again, recursive, the idea that you can get something to happen many, many times. He was able to make these, they called them splits, because you're literally splitting, you're out, you don't want to be there anymore. He was able to do splits inside of splits without the system knowing that the last one was validated. So he was able to take out ETH that wasn't even there in the first place. Again, this isn't a flaw in the concept of blockchain. It's just that when they wrote the smart contract, they didn't see that. This also went under a lot of criticism. People thought that they really should have seen this, that it might have been an inside job, that some developer kind of kept the secret of this code and exploited it. After what happened after is a major sort of political issue, something called the hard fork, which I wanted to bring up here. So to fix this and get all this missing money back, they decided to do a hard fork of the blockchain and say, from now on, this is the blockchain that counts, not that old one. And then a bunch of people said, you can't do that. A blockchain's immutable. It should always be the same. And then they tried to split off and make a classic one. So sometimes politics get in the way here. You know, you want the spirit of the project, and then someone gets away with millions of dollars. So sometimes politics wins out. Now, there's also attacks against sites. This is the number one thing that I think is going to own most blockchain implementations. The idea that you have this wonderful super secure technology and you wrap it around a horribly written web front end or something like that. We see this all the time. You know, people pay for these smart intelligent networks and they'll have this super hardened environment and then they'll write this really crappy code on top and an attacker sails right in, you know. So in 2013, the payments processor Inputs.io, They were compromised for about $1 million, and it was done how? With social engineering. So you've got this futuristic blockchain technology, and someone was able to social engineer credentials to get in and take the money. Steemit, it was a blockchain-based blogging platform. They were taken over because of no two-factor authentication. $85,000 in funds stolen. The final one is interesting. Coinbase, you'll hear all the time. If you do a search, you'll find people in forums swearing up and down that Coinbase was hacked. I lost $24,000, I lost this, I lost that. People swear up and down. If you read all the fine print though, Coinbase is actually the most insured of all the places where you could buy Bitcoin. They're insured against a mass breach. If something would happen to their servers, 97% of their coins are offloaded and they're insured. So you're insured up to $250,000, but there's one little caveat. not if something happens to your specific account only. So if you do something silly like lose your phone and someone gets your credentials, or someone puts malware on your phone or something like that, you're not covered, you're not insured. So they're doing the best they can, but they're not protecting individual folks. So you will hear about Coinbase hacking, but it's not really the back end that's getting hacked so far. And that brings us back to phones. December 7th, just a few months ago, a hacker compromised a very popular VC's phone, Bo Shen. So he was a big cryptocurrency VC dumping lots of money into the technology. They gained access to $300,000 in Augur and Ether from his phone's wallet. You know, so it begs the idea that you kind of want to have some security in place, too, on the end user. Ransomware is an obvious issue, right? You can, if your phone gets infected and it says, hey, pay money or you'll never get your wallet again, they kind of have you at that point, unless you've made some kind of backup. But we see malware, too, that steals credentials, which is super sneaky, because let's say it steals your Coinbase credentials, logs in as you, takes your money, and there's really not much you can do at that point. So Android phones are the more susceptible. I've never seen a worse patching situation than what's evolved in Android. Even Nexus devices have stopped getting security updates, some of them, which goes against the whole principle of Nexus in the first place. So iOS is definitely more secure here, and I hate to say that because I like Android, but a lot of the phones are really just in a poor security state right now. So cold wallets, the idea we brought up before, they're not exactly foolproof, right? So Bitfinex decided to make this grandiose quote here. The era of commingling customer Bitcoin and all the associated security exposures is over. That's it. They made that proud statement right before they were taken for $70 million. So they decided to do a cold wallet that has multi-sig through BitGo. And again, they're not really revealing what happens, but I think I know what happened. So if you make a mistake in coding, one of those trusted parties can do everything. So basically, BitGo had a flaw that allowed it to just initiate whatever it wanted. So hackers were able to take advantage of that. And that so-called cold wallet turned hot, and the $70 million vanished. Now, this brings us up to an interesting point, again, like I brought up with insurance. Bitfinex had to tell its users, well, we're going to give you back 36% of your money. That's it. Sorry. And they issued a new coin to do that, their own coin, which, if you think about it, might have been a ploy to generate more revenue by spiking it in value. You got to be careful, right? If you're going to keep your money in your cryptocurrency at a site, that kind of thing could happen. You know, you're not going to get all your money back. You're just going to get a little piece of it. So nodes are the other major attack. Just checking into the time. Major node attacks have been thwarted in the past. In the early days, 2010, when Satoshi was still hoping that people's altruism would prevent the network, one Bitcoin block had a flaw that was able to generate 184 billion transactions. And it really stood out immediately. They were able to create a soft fork, the idea that they put some patches out and let the network choose the better one, and then that sort of went away. But it was an early stumble. Ethereum just had a stumble like that in September. One block had an out-of-memory issue, and it was crashing, and they had to kind of fix it the same way. But what's interesting is it happened after that hard fork I talked about, and some people think it was a political attack, like they were angry about the hard fork, so they sabotaged Ethereum. It might be. In August, we also saw the first 51% attack that succeeded on a wide scale. Now, 51% attack is the idea that the network has to have consensus, that all the nodes have to agree on something to propagate a block. Over here, they were able to rent NiceHash hash power and attack the network. And as a result, they were able to get control and fork the blockchain over to their particular stream and get some money. Now, on a normal day-to-day, what we see when we're looking at blockchain applications is the port issue. Depending on what altcoin or whatever you're mining, there are certain ports that they use. A333 is a common one. Triangles uses different ones. They all use different ones. If we know what ports we're looking for, we could launch a denial of service against nodes and cause the network to shift one way or another. And again, it depends on whether it's a mainstream currency or not. So there's traditional risks to these new applications, right? So with digital assets, you could be attacking ownership. You know, what does it mean to lose ownership on a blockchain? Who are you going to complain to? The blockchain? It's not going to listen. Identity is a huge problem. If you do identity theft on the blockchain level, that's disastrous. You know, if you have one of these black box ideas I talked about, where that's your whole identity and it interacts with everything, with your driver's license, whatever goes on in your government, and someone takes that over, it's very, very difficult. There's no centralization to go to complain. With verifiable data, there's always malicious transactions, as we've seen. This happens all the time with the websites. And with smart contracts, we already saw the code flaws, right? The DAO. So that's the kind of stuff that we're seeing now, but that's not the kind of stuff that's the future issue here. I'm worried about the fact that we might be building on a digital house of cards right now, okay? So if we could go back to that one little quote, transactions that are computationally impractical to reverse. So in August 2015, the NSA publicly warned against using ECC, the type of encryption, elliptic curve cryptography, that's in blockchain. Okay, and this was the first thing that leapt out at me, because I was a physics major, and I've done a lot of work with quantum computers and quantum key distribution. So when I first saw blockchain, I was like, is this for real? Are we really building on ECC? So just really lightly, I don't want to get too deep here, but elliptic curve cryptography, it's public key system. You know, you have a public key and there's a private key. But unlike RSA, where it's just two huge numbers, it works on algebraic structure of an elliptic curve and taking the points on there. And that's where you get the difficult to reverse transactions. So you can't figure out what points were used easily. It would take more computing time than the universe has, in theory. So the public key here is used for encryption or signature validation, and the private key for decryption to prove that you're you. So in Bitcoin, for example, you have your wallet. The address is made of your public key, your private key, and your address where people would send the money. So the public key, like I said, it's derived from the private key by elliptic curve multiplication, which is in theory not reversible. There's that word theory again. So your address is derived by applying SHA-256, applying RIPMD, adding checksum. There has to be checksum for error correction in case you type a letter wrong, your money doesn't disappear forever. And anything that's used, anytime you use a Bitcoin address, anytime you spend money on the blockchain, all of a sudden your public key is exposed to the world. So again, the idea is that that's not a big deal. Your public key, it should be public, right? Well, not really. So there's this threat looming that is no joke. Quantum computers have been proven in a lab to be able to crack ECC. Small quantum computers, simple quantum computers, but everything starts small. So these machines exploit quantum weirdness of something called superposition. And superposition allows for the existence of qubits. They're quantum bits that can be both 0 and 1 at the same time, a percentage of 0, a percentage of 1. It's a bizarre concept, and I try to illustrate it here. It's the idea that you're not really polarized at 0 or 1. You could be somewhere in the middle, to keep it real simple. So qubits allow special algorithms on a quantum computer to do some very special things that a classical computer could never even hope to match. So I'm just going to give you a real simple example of what superposition is so you'll understand how quantum computers work. You won't be ready to engineer one after this. This is going to be Discovery Channel level, okay? That's it. So there's this famous thing called the double slit experiment, and if you were to fire electrons at a double slit, you would expect to see something like that, right? An electron is a little ball. Imagine if you were firing little pool balls or something. That's what you would expect if you don't know about quantum physics. So what really happens, though, is if you don't observe these slits and you don't see where the little particles are going, you get that. You get a wave pattern. Why? Why would, you know, think about it, if there were two holes in the back of the wall and I threw a bowling ball through. There's no way that I would form a wave pattern on the other side, right? But when you do it with electrons, it does. It's as if they're behaving like waves and causing interference. Now, this even works if you fire just one particle through the slit at a time. It's as if the particle is interfering with itself. So a particle goes through the left, and it interferes with the phantom particle on the right. I mean, it doesn't make any sense. But it gets even weirder, because if at any time you look at one of the slits and say, let's see which one the photon went through or the electron went through, the system knows you saw it, and it does that. It's like, oh, he saw that I'm supposed to be a little ball, so let me act like a little ball. Now, that's super weird, right? And that's particle wave duality, which is basically the core mystery of quantum mechanics. in a nutshell. So there's all sorts of interpretations as to why this happens. My favorite is many worlds interpretation, the idea that the particles are interfering with copies of themselves in another universe. And then when you observe, you decide that you're in this universe and the other universe goes away, and that's why you get that. It sounds crazy, right? But David Deutsch, the father of quantum computing, actually put forth the idea that if a quantum computer works, the only way it could work is if many worlds theory is true. He put forth the idea that you would need 10 to the 500 particles for a quantum computer to work, and the known universe only has 10 to the 90. So it's an interesting idea. The quantum computer wouldn't literally fit in our universe. So it's kind of fun. But back to what happens. So when you observe either slit, you're destroying this thing called superposition. Now, quantum computers have to maintain superposition to be able to do all the weird stuff we're talking about. So a lot of labs around the world have got them to maintain superposition for varying amounts of time, sometimes measured in milliseconds, sometimes measured longer, sometimes in super cold temperatures, sometimes in silicon, which is, of course, interesting, because then you could build machines that you don't have to have in the side of a mountain with refrigeration running 24 hours a day. University of Maryland, for example, came out with this amazing plan this year for a machine that could easily be scaled 5 qubits at a time. Just chain it up. You could end up with a machine in theory that could crack any encryption. So these machines are coming. And to crack encryption, they have to run something called Shor's algorithm. It was invented in 94 before there were any quantum computers. And it's the idea that using the periodicity of numbers and representing them as waves, you could find out the two numbers that are composing something like RSA. So you can have these two 400-digit numbers that you're looking for, and a normal computer can never do that. But a quantum computer could see them as waves and constructively build a guess as to which two numbers are the correct answer. So far, we've been able to do it in a lab to prove 21 equals 3 times 7. I'm sure you wouldn't have been able to do that on a piece of paper on your own, but a quantum computer did it. But it's not that it did it, it's how it did it. That's amazing. All the labs, including country-run ones, like the one in Australia, predict that within 3 years, they should be able to string together hundreds of qubits. And by modifying Shor's algorithm, you can crack ECC. So within 3 years, what might happen? We have all these Bitcoin transactions. They have a signature and a public key to verify the owner. That's all publicly available information. The minute you spend money, you know, the minute you give someone some Bitcoin, everything that a quantum computer needs to take your money from you going forward is out there. It can actually become you. It can use Shor's algorithm, find your private key, and start spending your Bitcoin. You don't really have to be online to do this. You could download the entire blockchain and go back from block one, from when Satoshi gave Hal Finney some Bitcoin in the first data test, all the way to now, and just go through and try every single transaction and try and get money from every single wallet that was ever exposed. One way to avoid this might be to just never reuse a wallet. That's not very practical, but that's one way to avoid it, because once you use it, you move the money elsewhere, and then it's not accessible anymore. I can't imagine how annoying that would be to you, but that's one way to avoid it. So one way around it might be a type of hash-based post-quantum cryptography. One example is Lamport signatures. It's the idea that instead of using something like ECC or RSA, you would have a public key that consists of 320 hashes, and what these are 160 pairs of random numbers that are made with RipeMD to be 160 bits long. So huge, huge numbers. And you would make your address a hash of your public key, and any time that someone tried to use it, they'd have to know which of each pair number was used to create a bit. So you create this huge complex number, and it's 160 times 160, so that's a huge number in bits. So even with Grover's algorithm or Shor's algorithm, it would just take computationally way too long to figure out which Lamport signature was used. So this is one way. The complication with this is we'd have to rewrite everything, which is what I'm worried about, that we'll get to a point where everything's too big, where everyone's doing blockchain and everyone's doing it poorly. And then we have to go through in banks and contracts and countries and like rewrite everything from scratch. So the time is now to start thinking about this sort of thing. So we eventually want to have post-quantum crypto. We just want to move away from ECC altogether. We want to look at things like code-based, hash-based, like we just did, last-based. The idea of these is they're all cryptography that seems to hold up because no quantum algorithms have been written to take advantage of them yet. The problem is they're not easily converted to blockchain right now. So we have a real serious issue here. One-time pad's a great one. If you create a one-time pad, just a long number, and apply that to some kind of like transformation, you can't reverse that with a quantum computer if you use it once. But how are you going to apply something like that to blockchain? So we need to write things that can just be plugged in and plugged in soon. A great example is this Open Quantum Safe project. They create an open source C library that they're trying to create a fork for SSL right now. I've been talking with them. How soon can we convert something like this to the whole PGP sort of solution and something that might fit in blockchain? Now, this is a serious issue that a lot of people are interested in. So as soon as possible, if you're doing anything in the blockchain field, take a look at what you're developing. And first of all, make sure, do these need to be blockchain? People are rushing to it for everything just because it's cool and it sounds neat. I'm not sure you need to do it everywhere just yet. I think it's still too early to trust. So you want to consider security, permanence of data. Sometimes being able to make changes is a good thing. A good example is in healthcare. You don't want someone's gender, for example, being immutable, because what if they have an operation one day in transition? You know, it's going to be immutable in the blockchain. So you got to consider things like that, like how immutable data is. And whether current technology may be superior, you know, not everything should be blockchain, you know, not just yet. So is your blockchain app an overlay to a proven blockchain protocol? You know, are you building on something others have already made some stumbles upon? Or are you making something so new and untested that you really are possibly putting yourself at risk? So that's immediate stuff, but then you should take it a step farther out. You have to prioritize testing the security of blockchains by their criticality. That really applies to any kind of application, but when I go in, I usually sit down with the stakeholders and we go over what the criticality is of these applications. You know, obviously anything emulating some kind of transactions of money, and a lot of times that's what they want because there's no transaction fees, et cetera. Those are the ones we do first. You know, you don't want to be able to do something like a recursive bug where I could start spending money, double spend. So you want to go against that kind of implementation first. There's all these basic flaws that might leak in, even if the crypto underneath is sound. And if you do have ethical hackers come in, you have to make sure they've worked with blockchain protocols before. I've gone into financials and I've spoken with development teams and they've never done anything in blockchain and now they're expected to be able to code securely in it. Or their internal testing team is like, yeah, we did an ethical hack of this. I'm like, is that your first blockchain ethical hack? It's like, yeah, okay, so, you know, maybe that's not the best time. It's not the best time for you to, you know, cut your teeth. The people who come in should have actually touched blockchain before. Looking ahead, like I said, the future of blockchain security is a big deal. You know, here's an example. You know, there are all sorts of federal incentives right now. The NSA had recommended that we get rid of all Suite B things, like including ECC. But now they're actually looking for public key post-quantum cryptography applications. There's a whole lot of money and prizes awaiting someone who comes up with the perfect post-quantum crypto that could just be plugged in. But my worry is that we're not going to be able to just plug it in, that it won't be something that we could take an infrastructure that's become into a snaking monster and just plug it in. You know, I think we need to really slow down and slow our roll, so to speak, and build this stuff in now. Consider investing your dev resources, if you do have anyone experienced in this, to give something back. This is very much a community, so it'd be good to see kind of like a sharing of information. And yeah, there's that link to the NIST thing. So let's make sure that, you know, we're building towards a valid future here. So I should be able to take a couple of questions here. There's also going to be a focus on session in 2024 from 3:45 to 4:15, if anyone wants to come there. And if you want to see all the zaniness going on in blockchain, you can follow me on Twitter, Constant Hacker. So I could probably take a couple questions here before we disperse. Or you could save it for the other room where it's a little more personal. Okay.
Yeah. So it's not so much a question, I suppose, as a comment, which is that for those who watched the crypto panel this morning, mm-hmm. It's not just quantum crypto that is concerned, there may well be mathematical attacks on ECC and on RSA. We heard that from the guys. It's not, however much you believe in post quantum or quantum, and I know a lot of people don't, we need to be aware of this stuff anyway, right?
Yes, absolutely. Good point. Quantum's just a sexier word. Well, the Lamport signature solution could be implemented now, and you can pair it up with something called Merkle tree hashing, and that should potentially protect you, because even if a quantum computer could crack it, given a lot of time, it would take a lot of time to do each and every one. Whereas if you leave it at ECC, it'll just be like, got it, you know, just like run through the blockchain and have a field day. So looking at something creative like that would be a good approach. And also, again, like I said, does every single thing need to be on blockchain just yet? I don't think so. I don't think just yet. I think there's certain things that need to mature first. Sure. Okay, so like I said, you know, we're going to have this other session. So if anyone thinks of a good question or just want to come chat, tell me what you're doing at your company or whatever, that's great. And I'll be in 2024 at 3:45. Thank you.